At the 50-yard line, I saw a fee. She was under the bleachers waiting for me. No, I never get high, but I'm smoking a weed. She been giving this freshman love since last June. The only senior girl with tattoos, and nobody can find out things that we do. She said, put your hands behind your head, let me blow your mind, kid. But don't get too excited. You can call me Stacy, you can call me love, you can call me baby, and all of the above. You can call me late night, and I'll be at your door. You can call me anything or anything you want, just don't call me yours. Bell rings, her parents left last night for Palm Springs. She's got the whole house empty for me. My brother, he needed the car, so I ran down 71st as fast as I can. I'm telling her everything I had planned. She said, I know we've been getting close, we can't get no closer. You'll get it when you're older. You can call me Stacy, you can call me love, you can call me baby, and all of the above. You can call me late night, and I'll be at your door. You can call me anything or anything you want, just don't call me yours.
Homies, it's summertime.
What better time of the year to buy new attire like jeans? It's actually like 90 fucking degrees outside. I don't care what the temperature is, you will always catch me wearing jeans. I think they should be the staple of your attire no matter what fucking time of the year it is. And if you know this bag, then you know ASOS. This is not sponsored at all. My favorite place to shop for men's clothing. A lot of plain, minimal stuff. Really high quality for a very low price. So what I'm trying to do is get a couple new pairs of jeans. I think like the basis of your outfits should be revolving around three color jeans. Your black, light washed blue, and then like a dark wash blue. So your light wash blue, your dark wash blue, and then your black. Problem is, I have good black ones and I have good light wash blue ones, except both of them have rips in their knees, which I'm fine with. I like wearing ripped jeans, but I need a pair of basic ones that don't have rips so I can, if I'm going to a more upscale or nicer attire place or party or whatever, I'd like to not wear ripped jeans all the time. So I ordered like 7 or 8 pairs of jeans from ASOS. ASOS does all free returns, all free shipping. So you can order like 10 things and then return it back for free, no problem, no question asked. And you can return it right into the bag that they sent it with you. Send like a little piece of tape on the back. So you throw your shit back into the bag, rip that off, tape it back up, and you're good to go. Super, super easy. So this is the first pair of black jeans, and then I ordered two more black ones. My suggestion would be to get a few different styles that you like what they look like online. If they have a European website as well as an American one, so make sure you're on the American one if you're shipping to America. I ordered two different styles and then a few different sizes, right, for trying the waist and trying the length and things like that. So since it's free returns, it literally does not damage your, you know, your financial situation at all. So I messed around with the different jeans, and then we also ordered a couple like lighter washed jeans to try on as well.
Blah-blah. It's officially launch week for the draft guide. It's June 28th right now, Friday. Draft guide comes out on Monday, so 3 days away. I have so much shit to do between now and Monday that honestly, I might just fucking jump straight behind you right out the window and say, fuck it, no more problems. I'm joking. I'm kidding, y'all. I might be depressed, but not suicidal. But for real, we have the draft guide.
So I'll say this, man. I am 1,000 times less stressed this summer than I was at this time last year. I remember multiple, and I'm sorry, for my shit's a mess right now. I just have so much going on. I remember multiple nights working from 8 a.m. almost till 2 a.m. the next day on the draft guide because there was just so many problems. And I was a little nervous about doing the draft guide on a different website, like a whole different kind of thing this year. But I'll tell you what, man, I'm really, really happy with how this is coming out right now.
But between now and Monday, so it's Friday, I have to do the Patreon live stream tomorrow. I have to finish the sleepers article within the draft guide. Me and Noah are filming Tuesday's video in a couple hours. I want to hit the gym at least twice before Sunday, rewrite an article that I had in the draft guide, and then, you know, the hardest part about it is like once you finish all the content within the draft guide, which is a massive, massive, massive amount of content, you have to run through it and act as if you're a customer. And that's a big thing, right? You have to make sure that the customer experience is really, really, really nice and nicely put together, which is tough because, you know, you have to look at it from the desktop point of view because I'm working on it on a desktop, but hella people are gonna be using it via the mobile version. So I need to run through it as if I'm going through it on the mobile version and then fix anything that might be fucked up. Mobile-wise, I have to do my top 250 big board for the draft guide. And the tough part about it all, the reason why it gets so difficult right now, the draft guide is so much content within itself and making sure it looks crisp and it's nice and it's a good experience, but I'm still doing 5 videos a week on top of that. So all the content I do for this, I also have to make sure that I have Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday's video all set up along with the Patreon live streams on Saturday. So it's about having your schedule in order and organized and knowing exactly when you are going to be doing things within this weekend, right? I have to have this all ready by Monday morning when it launches. Tomorrow, myself, Snacks, and Animal are going to the Fantasy Footballers show, the live show that they do at Gramercy Theater. I have to help my sister move apartments tomorrow morning. Then we're gonna vlog when we go into New York City for the Fantasy Footballers show. And then I have to get back here Sunday, finish everything for the draft guide Sunday, have Monday's video. I actually just finished Monday's video that's already uploaded. So as you can see, I'm fucking all over the place, which is why we're locked and loaded with monsters and shitty fucking non-natural protein bar foods. This is just how I get though. It's a crazy fucking grind. But I'll tell you what, we're about a month into doing 5 videos a week. And like I said, I am not stressed anywhere near to the level that I was last summer. Things are going well. If you guys are watching this, I'm sure it's way later than June 27th. It's probably like mid-July at this point. Let's get a little update on business things, on social things. We hit 4,000 Twitter followers yesterday, which is fucking cool as hell. I don't know why 4,000 people like to follow me. In terms of draft guide sales, let's see, we have about 430 sales right now. Last year, last summer, we sold 500 altogether. My goal was to hit, I wanna hit 1,000 sales. And at this pace, I don't know if we're gonna hit that. But then again, July, August, it could pick up at like a ridiculously rapid pace. Like if I hit a couple videos that go off for like 60,000, 80,000, 100,000 views, I think the sales will probably pick themselves up. And I don't think that's outrageous. I put out a video a couple weeks ago that hit like 35,000 or 40,000 views, which is fucking crazy. But the views and stuff have kind of tapered off. I'm trying to figure out why. I think it might be something with the YouTube algorithm. So I've been putting out individual player outlook videos, having someone chop up player bits from my long form videos and putting them out every Sunday, like 8 at a time. And those don't get a lot of views. They'll get anywhere from like 500 to 2,000, which is cool for the people that want to look at individual player outlooks. But I think that's fucking with my algorithm because YouTube looks at like, you know, consistently, are these videos all getting 5,000 to 10,000 views? If they're doing really well, all of them will keep feeding you all those views. And I think these are kind of shooting them down a little bit. So I'm at a crossroads with whether or not I want to keep doing those. YouTube, we are at 17,796 subs. We'll be at
18,000 by the time you guys watch this video, I'm sure. The other reason that this time of the year stresses me out so much, on top of having to do so much work, the work is not what really gets to me. It's the fact that this is like my window for, not to sound like materialistic or money motivated, because I'm not, but this is when I need to get my money, because I'm only gonna make, most of my income throughout the entire year is gonna come from June, July, August, September, 95% of it. So I need to make sure that I'm fucking bringing enough in to help me support the rest of the year. And luckily, the affiliate deal I made with Draft, you guys know I'm partnered up with Draft.com, and I'm not gonna get into any actual numbers, but that has given me a fat fucking cushion in terms of money that I'm bringing in, which has been really important. And if I didn't, it's crazy, man. The serendipity of how things happen is just like, so listen to this story, right? The way I even got linked up with Draft.com, that's a platform that I've been using for a long time, right? For years at this point, and never had any sort of affiliation with them other than like an affiliate code, but that was not like an official contractor partnership, which is what we have now. I'm at the point right now where my Twitter account is used for like value only, right? I only tweet out shit that is valuable to people, where a lot of people post like, oh, here's my new blog, here's my new podcast, here's my new video or whatever, and they'll spam it on Twitter. It's like, that's not what Twitter is for. Twitter is for giving valuable information in 140 characters or fewer, or 280, whatever they fucking have it at now. And it's okay to promote you. Like, I did that for a long time, but I made a conscious decision that I will never spam or promote my other platform stuff on there, right? I wanna use every single social platform exactly the way it was intended to be used, you know? So I don't wanna be like, new blog post, new video, blah, and keep posting that on Twitter. And it's funny because one of the mock drafts I did on Draft was one of the last times I did that. And I posted it, and I was like, here's my new video or whatever. And one of the dudes from Draft commented under it, said this was dope, whatever. I ended up, I DM'd him, we linked up, we went out for drinks, and then I went to the Draft office, the FanDuel office in New York City, because they're owned by FanDuel, and the rest is history. But like, had I not, imagine I just didn't post that video on Twitter that day, then he never would have commented, I never would have linked up with him, and we never would have had that kind of deal. So it's like these little fucking things that mean so much and are just like crazy storylines in your path, man. And I'm super thankful that happened. And that's the other tough thing is the money is good, but how long is this gonna be available for me, right? Is this like a thing I can depend on every single year? Probably not. One of my biggest revenue streams was marketing for a company last year, which brought in like 40 to 50% of the entire revenue I had last year before I was full-time YouTube and fantasy stuff. And then this year they just decided that, you know what, we're not gonna be doing Facebook and Instagram advertising. And it's like, I can't be mad at them. They're doing what's best for their business or what they think is best for their business, but that cuts out a massive portion of the money that I brought in last year. So now I need to find a new way to replace that and then build upon that. And there will always be things like that pop up where I need to innovate and reinvent how I'm bringing in money. So things are not money motivated for me whatsoever, but I understand that it's important. Everything I do is based on the fact that I value my like freedom and flexibility and my ability just to work from home and do whatever I want at any time of the day, right? If I wanna wake up at noon, I could do that. If I wanna go to the gym from 2 p.m. to 5 p.m., I don't know why the fuck I would ever do that, but if I did, I'm allowed to do that, right? I don't have anyone telling me when I can be creative. I don't have anyone telling me I have to do this, and that, and the other thing, and am I building something 8 hours a day for someone else that I'm never gonna care about? Like, that's what I value, but I understand that money is what unlocks me to be able to enjoy those things. So you have to look at both sides, and I actually just got this. Speaking of money, I just got this tattoo last week. It says, "Don't take the money." The title of one of my favorite songs ever by Bleachers. Bleachers is probably my favorite band ever. If you've never listened to Bleachers, go listen to Bleachers immediately. Go listen to Don't Take the Money. Go listen to Roller Coaster. Listen to, oh man, there's a lot of songs. Go follow me on Spotify. My username, I think, is NAE825. I have like 8 really good playlists, and the Bleachers are on like everyone. Somehow, they're like on my workout playlist and also on like, anyways, Don't Take the Money. It's a song title of one of my favorite songs, but what it means to me is like, it's a reminder, don't take the money. It's like, don't make decisions. A lot of people make decisions based off, money's more of like a symbolic thing in this sense. Don't take the money, but don't make decisions based on short-term things, right? A lot of people take the money, but sell out on the things that they actually value more than that. And it all kind of comes back, it's all full circle for me. So, you know, when I'm faced with a decision, I see that tattoo and I'm like, don't take the money. It's like, what does that mean? You're always in this for the long term. This is a long game, and make decisions based on like your heart, what you will regret the least, right? Money is almost never the right answer. It solves things in a sense, but it's never really the long-term answer. stressor when it's competing with things you do value that are emotionally, you know, ingrained in you. Man, these fucking tangents really go on a wild spin most of the time in my vlogs. Hope you guys are enjoying these vlogs. I appreciate you hanging on for this long if you did. So back to the draft guide, which is killing me because it's like 90 degrees outside and all I want to do is be outside right now. But we gotta make sacrifices, so let's get this braid. All right, it's July 1st. It's July 1st, which means it's launch day. It's 10:42 a.m. I got this thing launching at 12 p.m. It was originally supposed to launch at 8 a.m., I'm not gonna lie, but I just changed the countdown timer on the website because I ain't gonna have this shit ready. But I did that a couple days ago, so I don't think anyone actually noticed, which is phenomenal. I'm not even done with it yet, to be honest. I have to finish up a few of the rankings. For the most part, I'm done with it. I've been up since about 6 a.m. just like proofreading everything, and I didn't even get all that done. But so we do over here at Big Dogs. We're like a calculated fucking mess, basically. A lot of craziness, but in the end, it works itself out. This weekend was phenomenal. We went to the Fantasy Footballer Show. So me, Snacks, and Animal were supposed to go because I built a relationship with, you know, if you guys are in my audience, you probably are aware of who the Fantasy Footballers are. I've built a relationship with the three guys on that show, Jason, Mike, and Andy, basically through social media, but I've had them on my channel and I've interviewed them before. So if any of you guys are like new subscribers, I did a series where I would interview the top entrepreneurs in the fantasy football space, mostly during the off season. So right after the season ended in last summer, there's a playlist on my channel if you want to go check those out. Those are a lot of fun to make. But I built a relationship with them, and the Footballers do a live tour every summer where they go like to the biggest cities in the country, do like a live podcast there. They were coming to New York City this past weekend. Andy hit me up and was like, yo, I'm gonna drop a couple tickets for you at Will Call if you wanna come to the show. And I'm like, hell yeah, I wanna come to the show. I mean, Andy's just been such a good dude. He's like, in a sense, he's not a mentor because like you usually would work closely with a mentor, but there have been plenty of times where I've reached out to him via Twitter, email or whatever, asking him like personal questions like about business. And he's always super helpful, super in-depth, always transparent with me when I have him ask questions about the business side of things. So in a sense, he's been like a mentor that I can go to and ask questions, because obviously they've taken a very similar, our brands are very, very different, but we've taken a similar path. And I really think that like us two and maybe like one or two other brands are like the only ones really, really building something that's really strong at the foundation in terms of being an actual brand and not just a fantasy media company, if that makes sense. But the night was crazy because something came up with Snacks, a family emergency. He had to cancel last minute, unfortunately. We had three tickets, me, Animal, Snacks. Animal still came in. We were like trying to get people to meet up with us prior to the show to do like a live meetup for anyone that watches our podcast or whatever. And we told them to meet us at the Gramercy Ale House because the show was at the Gramercy Theater in New York. It was right around the corner, so we're like, yo, if there's anyone in the audience going to the show, because again, the audiences overlap, come meet us there. We'll go pound some margs, some beers, whatever, and then we'll go to the show together. The show started at 7. We didn't get to the Ale House until like 6:50 because it was like there was train cancellations and there was car accidents in front of where Animal was going, so it took us a while to get there. But we ended up meeting with a few people that, you know, were staying there to meet with us, which was really cool because first time that's ever happened. We go to the Gramercy Theater. We're like waiting in line. I'm waiting. Will Call. Go get my tickets. And someone's like, yo, Nick, is that you? And I turn around and I'm like, I didn't know who the person was. This kid named Andy, who's been following me now for like 2 years. And this was the first time I've ever ran into people who actually like recognized me or knew who I was from YouTube. And that ended up happening like a handful of times, 6, 7, or 8 times when we were actually in the theater. So kind of felt pretty fucking cool. People like, you know, knew who I was just from over the internet. After the show, Footballers, who were incredible live, I don't know how they do it, to be honest. I feel like I would shit the bed the first time I went live. That's something that I will eventually do. I'm gonna do some kind of tour, but it's not gonna be like their tour because they have everything set up really nicely. Mine's gonna be like me asking subscribers to crash on their couch when I go to different cities and shit. After the show though, you know, everyone kind of waits in line to take pictures and meet and greet them, but I wanted to, you know, hang out and like actually talk to them for a while. So I let everyone do their thing. And then afterwards, I was like the last person to go up and talk to them. And we were hanging out, just chatting for a minute. And then Mike, one of the guys in the Footballers, was like, what are you doing tonight? And I was like, oh, whatever the fuck you guys are doing, like, let's do it. So like, all right, we're gonna go back to our hotel in Midtown, come meet us on hotel bar. So we go over there, meet them there. Then we go out to this other bar in Midtown. And, you know, we're just like kicking with them until, I don't know, like 1:30, 2 a.m., pounding margaritas, pounding some White Russians. It's a really good time. Their team, like the whole team, them three, but like we met Brooks. If you guys listen to the podcast, you obviously know who Brooks is. We're hanging out with Brooks. We're hanging out with the rest of the team that organizes everything for them. So just a really, really, really awesome team. I mean, you can get the feeling just from listening to them that they're really good dudes, but they are, you know, that and so much more in person. So it was a really fun night. And afterwards, I have a really big problem where every time I get drunk, I want to bike ride home. So
as soon as we left the bar, I found one of the city bikes. Wilson, my roommate, gets city bike as a perk from his work for free. So I just signed into his account on my phone, and I used the city bike all the time, probably like 3 or 4 times a day. And I rode from Midtown. Most of you guys will probably not be familiar with this, but I rode from Midtown down to where the Williamsburg Bridge is so I can take the subway back home. Keep in mind, this is at like 2:30 a.m. and I'm hammered. And I looked up the next day how far the bike ride was. It was 4.5 miles through New York City on a shitty city bike. I'm telling you, if there's a way that I'm going, like by going, I mean passing away, it's I'm gonna bike ride home drunk one night and get absolutely demolished by like an 18-wheeler. I biked all the way down to the Williamsburg Bridge, took the subway home, and yeah, basically since I got home, I've been working on the draft guide for like 36 hours nonstop. And that's where we are now. So the draft guide sales are almost at 500, and that's 500 pre-orders. That's fucking incredible. Because I remember going into last summer, my goal, I wanted to have 100 pre-order sales. And I was like, there's no way that's gonna happen. And I hit that. I did end up hitting 100 pre-order sales. And then my goal this summer, I didn't put a goal in terms of like the number of sales or the number of pre-order sales I wanted to do, but I knew I wanted to hit around 1,000 sales altogether in terms of like quantity. But I also wanted to hit a certain revenue point. Like I wanted to hit $25,000 in sales. We're almost at 500 pre-sales. So that gives me all of July and all of August and that first week of September to double the sales count. I'll be honest with you, I'm not sure if I'm gonna hit that. I would expect the sales to kind of start picking up throughout the months, but I'm happy with where we're at. I think like the product that I'm putting out, I'm really, 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 really happy about. Normally I'm nervous to put things out because like I don't ever like proofread things and double check them over, but I feel like all around the product is just super fucking solid. So I don't feel bad charging $30. If you get, you know, the double package, the rookie dynasty guide, plus the season long, it's $50, which is an expensive product in the fantasy football space. And I was super hesitant to price it at that in the beginning of the summer. But at the end of the day, the amount of work and the amount of, hopefully, the amount of value that I give out to the customers and the audience is easily worth that and more. And it's something that I'll be updating throughout the entire summer. So the amount of work I'm gonna put in from what I've already started back in, you know, the beginning of June or, you know, midway through May until when the season kicks off in September, I'll make a lot of money off this, but I'll probably, the money will break down to not like a crazy amount of dollars per hour with the amount of work that I put into it. So I'm happy. In terms of money that's it's brought in, I'm not really sure off the top of my head, because I mean, you could do the math, 500 sales, but there's like 3 different price points. There's the rookie guide by itself, there's the season long guide by itself, and then there's the package of both of them. And there's been sales that have been a mixture of all 3, right? Some have only got one, some have got the other, some have got both. And I've also mixed the price point multiple times throughout the summer so far. Like I'll have sales and then I'll move the price up and move it back down. So it's really hard to pinpoint exactly off the top of my head how much I brought in so far. But I would say it's probably in the five figures. Actually, probably definitely not 6 figures, but it's probably, I don't know, between 10 and 13K at this point. So like I said, we're about halfway there for quantity in sales and we're about halfway there for money in sales. So we're looking good. I'm really hoping like one of these videos I put out in the next month or so blasts off. I need one of those to hit. We've been seeing good numbers on videos. Like when I put one out, usually by the next day it's at like 5,000 views, but then they taper off. I'm looking for like one or two to just hit and pop off and go 80,000, 100,000, 150,000 views. And that would make me hit that draft guide sale. I think so. Things are looking up. This is probably gonna be the last bit of the vlog because I know I've been talking for a long, 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 long time. That being said, if you enjoyed the video, a thumbs up would be fantastic. Leave any comments you got down below if you want to know more about any of the marketing, business, my personal life, whatever you want. I'm here to serve y'all. So I will see you in the next vlog, in the next fantasy video, whatever, whatever, whatever. I gotta finish the draft guide. Hopefully you will be enjoying this by the time you watch this video. I love you. Goodbye. We just went live about an hour ago. My heart was fucking racing out of my chest. The worst part about this stuff is the immediate 10 minutes after, people, oh, my username isn't working. Oh, why is this not working? Blah, 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 blah. Most of the time, they're literally like on the wrong website. Like it's not even where the draft guide is. Like you're on a completely wrong website. Or they're just signing in with the wrong usernames and wrong email addresses and stuff. So you turn from, when you're like in a startup, when you're in a spot like me, you go from being the owner / the tactician putting in the content and stuff to fucking customer service rep. So I'm gonna be playing customer service rep for the next 24, 48 hours. Actually, realistically, the next 48 to 72 days while the summer is here and people are continually buying the draft guide. But we raked in like 50 sales over the last like hour or so, which is pretty awesome. And we just hit 500 draft guide purchases as of the last purchase, which came in like 2 minutes ago. So I thought it'd be cool to get that on tape. So it's Monday, but now I'm driving back to New Jersey. We're gonna film Fade the Public. We got a good episode coming out this week. We're doing the whole thing outside for July 4th. Then it's business as usual. Content, 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 content. So it makes the world go round. Peace.